You go home with somebody meet in a bar. You're gambling with your life.
People often say, is there an AIDS vaccine? And we always say, yes, there is. It's called a rubber, a prophylactic.
You don't know what that fellow has been through. You don't know where he's been, who he's been with. You're playing Russian roulette.
I have AIDS. And I don't know how long I have to live.
No, quite honestly, I don't think I'll make it that much longer. If I make it through the winter, I'd be surprised.
In a war, you lose your youngest. We're at war now with this AIDS virus, and we're losing our young people.
If people would take the time to learn about AIDS, that their fears would go away. I was never afraid of Ryan after they told us that he had AIDS. I still picked him up and held him and kissed him.
We're having real trouble here. A lot of us are dying.
AIDS is going to be to Minnesota what it is now currently in New York and San Francisco.
We've had 16 women die with this disease in this city. We've had children die with disease in this city. We know the individuals, and they look a lot like you. They look a lot like me.
CBS News Special. AIDS Hits Home. With Dan Rather.
In 5 short years, according to the Public Health Service, AIDS could become one of the top 10 causes of death in the United States. In 5 short years, the AIDS death toll could strike 200,000 people. Right now, perhaps 1.5 million Americans are carrying the AIDS virus. AIDS is striking home in America, striking home in ways scarcely imaginable a few years ago. Tonight, CBS News reports from the front lines of the battle against AIDS, from the hospital wards treating men, women, and children. We'll examine how AIDS has affected the sexual revolution. We'll report on how AIDS is an increasing danger to heterosexuals, and how AIDS has turned neighbor against neighbor. The images we have found are brutal and heartbreaking. But if America is to come to terms with this killer, they must be shown.
I'm sick and I hurt. I don't want to hear about prostitution and drug use and gay. I didn't want to hear about it when I was healthy. I don't want to hear about it now. I don't need to hear about it. That's irrelevant. The fact is that I'm sick and I need help.
Meredith is not an intravenous drug user. She's not gay. She's not a prostitute or a hemophiliac. She got AIDS from her boyfriend. He used drugs.
Well, when I walked in the room, he started screaming at me, I have AIDS. Or they think I have AIDS. You know, after denying the fact that I could get AIDS, all of a sudden it smacked me in the face.
Slowly, that truth is beginning to dawn on straight America. AIDS is not a gay disease. AIDS is a venereal disease, and it can pass from men to women and women to men. It just happened in this country to hit the gay community first.
In very sexually active groups, once the virus enters that group, you have the ingredients for a true explosion in that population.
Already has hit Africa, where AIDS has always been a heterosexual disease, and where it's killing men, women, and children in staggering numbers. The experts say you can't draw conclusions about what's ahead for this country by looking at Africa. The situations are too different. But today, AIDS has a foothold in the straight population here, too.
Among heterosexuals today, I think the prevalence of infection is extremely low, less than 1%. It's not going to stay there. It's going to increase.
It is actually occurring at a frightening rate.
Dr. Margaret Fischel works in a Miami AIDS unit.
Now probably 18-20% of the cases we are now seeing at this time in our medical center can be related to heterosexual transmission.
A large population of drug users and Haitians may skew the Miami numbers, But because of the long incubation period, it's impossible to know just how widespread this virus really is, how likely one is to encounter it. One controversial study found high rates among Army recruits. Critics say the study included too many drug users. Its author insists it is a warning.
We did a cross-sectional survey of the American population of young people, and we found a lot of virus. We found a very serious silent epidemic.
I think there's a subgroup of the population, if you're sexually active, have multiple contacts, I think, you know, I would be concerned.
For people like Sheila, who got AIDS from her bisexual husband, the concern is twofold, both for herself and for partners she may have infected inadvertently.
I have been with other men since I've been with my husband, and of course I had no idea I had been infected at the time. And of course, since I found out, I haven't been with anyone.
Did you tell them?
In one instance, I told someone.
And in the other instances?
I decided it would probably be kinder not to. Since in both instances, it was a one-time thing.
There's dispute over how much risk there is in a one-time thing, but the potential danger exists, especially with prostitutes.
16% of the streetwalkers around the 11th Avenue area and in some other areas of Manhattan show the exposure to the virus.
It's unclear how many men will get AIDS from prostitutes, how many women from bisexuals, how many men and women from drug users. The hope is that people will realize there is danger in sex with someone you don't know, in sharing needles, and that in the U.S., heterosexual AIDS will stay confined to a few percent. And no one hopes that more intensely than those with AIDS.
This is a real disease, and a lot of people are going to die, and a lot of children. And people have to stand up and become educated. They have to.
What it creates for them is what, you know, has to be a nightmare situation.
Even for doctors so schooled in the ways of death, AIDS is a terrible enemy.
You have to realize that, no, they're not going to get better. They're going to get worse, and they're going to die.
Okay. Dr. Terry Coates makes her rounds at St. Vincent's Hospital in New York.
You're moving up pretty well.
Pardon me?
You're moving up pretty well. You don't seem to be using your oxygen as much. You know, you want to say something to cheer him up, or you want to say something to lighten things a little bit. And it's the only way that I can deal with it.
Little victories, says Dr. Coates, a day at a time.
You can't look at these people as if, well, we might as well not do anything. They're going to die anyway. Because what is a week to someone who doesn't have much time at all? You know, a week might be worth, a week may be the rest of their life.
Life, AIDS, and the shadow of death. A struggle being played out many places across America.
12:32, Ken's Daily in your lunch hour from Love 98, KCFO. Good looking day in Tulsa, aside from the day.
Tulsa, Oklahoma, where you can find Christian rock on the radio, the home of Oral Roberts University, the heart of the Bible Belt. The last place you'd expect to find an AIDS problem, not anymore.
AIDS has come to Middle America. AIDS has come to Tulsa.
Even in Tulsa, people meet every week in encounter groups trying to come to grips with AIDS.
You lay in bed and say, God, you're dying. You're 28 years old and you're dying. That's a funny feeling to die.
In the American heartland, where traditional values are cherished, they are beginning to understand that AIDS is no longer a strange disease that only happens someplace else. AIDS hit home in Stillwater, Oklahoma, where identical twins, Randy and Ron Anderson, grew up, one gay, the other straight. Now Randy has AIDS. It is still difficult for Ron to accept.
You know, it's something that happens to the other guy. And when it, you know, hits somebody as close as a twin brother, well, you definitely know that something can happen to you just as quickly. I have never, ever believed that I was going to die. Not once. I don't believe it.
There is at least a chance that Randy can overcome the disease. Early next year, the twins will undergo a rare bone marrow transplant, a procedure that has shown some promise in the past.
Hope it works. And, you know, that's what I pray about, that God let it work. He gave us the opportunity to do it. Now we just got to kind of rely on him to let it take its course and work.
For Randy Anderson in Oklahoma, there is at least hope. But here in Kansas City, there are AIDS victims, as is so often the case, whose only hope is that someone somehow can ease their suffering.
So how have you been since you got home?
I'm just tired.
Glad to see you dressed for the weather.
Yes. Today.
Kansas City, too, is learning to deal with AIDS. The Good Samaritan Project here is a privately run hospice, a place where people with AIDS can live and be cared for, a home where people who have no place else to go can come to die.
I'll do it.
Good Samaritan Project is Virginia.
Virginia Allen runs the place.
Hi.
We've had 16 women die with this disease in this city. We've had children die with disease in this city. We know of children that are exposed to it, that are carrying the virus, that now have been diagnosed with AIDS. We know the individuals, and they look a lot like you. They look a lot like me.
In the last year alone, more than 100 men, women, and children have died of AIDS in Kansas City, including one woman who got the disease when she was raped.
One at a time, baby, one at a time.
For those who live here, it is all one step at a time, trying to cope with pain, uncertainty, and frustration.
Hello?
This isn't enough, you know. This is not what I wanted out of life, to live in a house like this.
What's the hardest part for you?
Hardest part? Knowing I'm going to die. That's the hardest part. It's a real hard thing to accept. There's days when I say, well, God, you know, I pray to my God, take me today, you know, just get this over with. And there's days that I say, oh, God, thank you for the hope.
Hope and comfort also come through Good Samaritan Project volunteers who visit AIDS victims and their families. Olivine Henley visits Michael every week, most of the time just to listen.
I talked to my mom again on Sunday, and then it took me almost a day to read this. Dearest Michael, I'm still reeling from our phone conversation last night. Know that we love you. I'm still entertaining my right to denial. When the going gets tough, though, the tough get going. Very last but not least, know we love you. Mom.
Maybe it's less painful for those of us that are involved, although the pain is there and the sorrow and the grieving is there. But we can also look at, we made a difference in their lives while they were dealing with, trying to live with a fatal illness, that we made a difference.
To gauge how Americans view the AIDS epidemic, CBS News polled 823 adults nationwide last week. One out of 20 people said they knew someone who has AIDS. Most with an opinion said they thought the government isn't spending enough on AIDS research. And though the evidence is AIDS is spread only by sex, contaminated needles, and bad blood, sizable numbers still thought you could get it from casual contact. Roughly a third believed it's transmitted by kissing or by drinking from the same glass. Not so, say experts. More than 80% of the people we questioned expressed concern that AIDS will spread to the general population. And one out of every four young adults said that fear of AIDS has made them more careful about sex.
Do you think about AIDS when you go out?
Sometimes. I think more these days you have to be more cautious of who you go out with, because nobody wants to get AIDS.
For a very long time, heterosexuals, straight Americans, thought AIDS was somebody else's problem. That is, if they thought about AIDS at all. AIDS is what homosexuals got. But a scary reality is starting to hit home, that the AIDS virus is out there, and it's not just gays who are catching it.
Here we go!
So in 1986, the sexual revolution is undergoing a sexual evolution.
Before, maybe I used to go out with 6, 7, 8 girls, and I would take the one-night stance, and I'll admit it. I wouldn't do that now. There's no question I wouldn't do that now. It's not worth it.
Because?
Because of AIDS.
This bad, you're back in the bed.
Do you ever wonder about some guy you went out with 4 years ago?
Yes.
You really do?
I have a particular boyfriend in mind at the moment.
What do you...
You know why? Because this guy told me, he revealed to me, that he had this thing that he would go with prostitutes when he could.
So what do you wonder?
I wonder if he had AIDS. Out of all the people that I know, he always comes into my mind when I think about it.
Anybody can get it. Anybody can get it. Anybody is susceptible. And I think you increase the risk if you're dating a number of people. If you're going home with people you barely know, you think it's sensational. And you don't know what that fellow has been through. You don't know where he's been, who he's been with. You're playing Russian roulette.
Russian roulette. That's the analogy holds up in that if you lose at either,
you die. It's very simple. Is it worth it? Is this man worth it?
It will not come and get you. You've got to go out and get it.
Dr. Terry Crenshaw, a California authority on AIDS.
People are under the illusion that, you know, they can judge character and that they're going to be able to be selective. But that truly is a fallacy, because when you have sex with someone today, you also have sex with everyone they've had sex with for the last 5 or 7 years. And there's absolutely no way to judge the character of that particular population or even have any idea what the numbers are.
Alexandra is 41. She lives in Los Angeles. She is heterosexual and has ARC, AIDS-related complex, a possible forerunner of AIDS.
Dan, I normally wait a fair amount of time before I sleep with somebody, but we seem to have so much in common that I just slept with him sooner than I normally would have. Slept with him 4 times.
She had no idea the man she slept with was bisexual.
Before I slept with him, I said, you know, have you been with many women, you know, since you've been here? Never thinking to ask, have you been with many men since you've been here? And he said, no, actually I haven't been. I've hardly been with anybody. I've been more concentrating on my career.
It could be years before Alexandra knows if she, in fact, will come down with a full-blown case of AIDS.
I just thought I had the flu, you know, something that could be taken care of, but I didn't think, I never gave it even a thought about AIDS.
But it was AIDS, a suburbanite who had no idea of how she got it. She wasn't an intravenous drug user, she had no transfusions, and she was married.
I cried and cried because I knew, I thought I was going to die. I thought, I'm done with, I'm going to die, you know. But then my mom said, no, you're not, no, you're not, you know, you're going to be fine. Just get to the doctors. Get yourself taken care of. So that's what I did, and so far everything's worked out okay.
She told us that 1 year ago. 6 weeks later, she was dead.
She didn't really realize how serious the illness was.
And what was your reaction when you found out?
I died.
This is her husband. He had a secret his wife didn't know about until she got AIDS. Your wife didn't know then?
My wife had no idea.
That you were bisexual?
No.
Even though his wife died of AIDS, he is healthy. He may only be a carrier. Forgive me for asking this question.
Sure.
It's not easy, but do you feel in some way as if you murdered your wife?
No. No. Though the small town that I came from on the East Coast have labeled me a murderer.
Because she's dead?
Mm-hmm.
For a very long time, straight America thought AIDS was somebody else's problem. Straight America doesn't think that way anymore.
If I make it through the winter, I'd be really surprised.
St. Vincent's again. Call the patient Paul. He's 33.
You talked about making your own arrangements, and you thought that was best. Funeral arrangements are one thing. Death and the fact and the finality of death is another.
I must admit, I'm a little angry about it, but... you gotta look at it like it's a fact of life, and it's gonna take place at some point. It's just that I have some limitations that you don't.
Hospitalized for the fourth time.
Maybe we can just slow this down a little.
You mentioned that you'd considered suicide.
I think anybody that was in this situation has. If they say they haven't considered it, they gotta be lying.
But in the end, you voted not to do it. You voted with yourself and decided to stick with life.
I think by having this disease, life is a little bit more precious to me than it was beforehand.
I do glance out the window and see what kind of day it is, and particularly on weekends when I used to sleep in, it's now get up and get out because it's a beautiful day and I'm not quite sure how many more of these I'm going to have.
Jeff, can you tell me how sick you were when you first had AIDS?
When I was first diagnosed, I was in the hospital with pneumocystis, and I literally couldn't get out of bed. I was so weak. Extremely sick, very severe form of pneumonia.
A new drug, AZT, put Jeff's disease on hold. No patients taking AZT have been cured, but most lives have been prolonged.
AZT is a first step. It is an important first step. It is proof that something can be done about the AIDS virus.
It wasn't a simple step to take. Scientists were at first baffled, even intimidated by the elusive disease. Finding and testing a drug like AZT was no accident. Scientists learned as much about the AIDS virus in 2 years as they did about cancer or heart disease in 2 decades.
You can see the results. They were done in a scientific, objective manner. This is the first time that there's been a controlled study from the laboratory to the clinic. The drug does something.
But getting the drug is something else. Until federal approval, strict guidelines have been set that determine who will and who won't get the drug. And even when approval comes, supplies will be limited.
Yes, I want and need AZT. Because I know that it can prolong my life.
The mother of this 3-year-old AIDS patient asks anonymously,
when we're talking about a disease like AIDS that's deadly and you have nothing to lose, why keep it from them?
I may very well get it, but I don't have it yet. I think it should be as widely distributed as is necessary, since it is the only thing that we have so far.
Under the stringent guidelines now in effect, he didn't qualify for AZT.
I would like to take it, yes, of course. If I don't get it, well...
One week after we did this interview, he was dead.
Come on, ready, baby.
And there was times when I just couldn't take it. I would say, God, please take me, get it over with, you know. I don't want to live anymore. But then my girlfriend said to me one day, listen, I'm getting real tired of this. If you don't get up off your butt and help yourself, God and nobody else is going to help you. So, from that day on, it woke me up when she said that to me. From that day on, I just got the will to live, and that's the main thing, the will to live.
St. Vincent's. Call him Tony. Doctors think he got AIDS from shooting drugs. He's determined to beat it.
I prayed, and I just willed myself to get better. I said to myself, well, I got all these people out there that are sticking by me. If I'm not going to do it for myself, I'm going to at least do it for them.
So far, nearly 15,000 Americans have died of AIDS, all hoping, at first, to tough it out.
It's a wonderful attitude to have.
You got to have it, because like I said, the will to live is what it's all about.
How much of this, I'm not afraid, I don't have any fear of that, is you psyching yourself up for what you know you face?
This ain't such a big bad guy that scares me at all. I mean, like I said, I fought bigger guys than this. This don't mean nothing. It's just another little fight to me.
I was very young and had started off using other drugs first and then followed into the intravenous drug use.
She is 30 years old and she is suffering with AIDS.
My contact with the disease was through my husband's IV drug use.
They have been married for 18 years. They have four sons.
I believe that I contracted it from a sexual relationship I was in before I was married with someone who was bisexual.
A wife and mother with AIDS. Her child, diagnosis uncertain.
I take responsibility for my own actions. I take responsibility for my own relationships. And it was not a risk that I was aware of.
My life is my life. That's the only way I know, is the way I did it.
I am not ashamed of my diagnosis.
There are a few victims of AIDS who are willing to speak out publicly, but she is trying to make people understand.
What's the worst thing about this, for both of you?
If something happens to me today or tomorrow, I have nothing for my kids. I have nothing to leave them.
But in a certain sense, her children have more than these children do because hers are not infected with the AIDS virus. Some have called this a 20th century leper colony. It is the pediatrics AIDS ward of a New York hospital. And it is home to these babies because foster parents are virtually impossible to find for children with AIDS. Dr. Elaine Abrams.
This little boy is about 18 months, and he's quite ill now. He has AIDS and has major problems with his blood system.
The Centers for Disease Control say about 360 children in this country have full-blown AIDS, but they don't keep track of the children who have tested positive but don't show symptoms. AIDS is even more brutal to children because their immune systems are so fragile.
As he grows older, eventually he'll know that he's sick, and maybe slowly but surely I'll just let him know why he's sick and what kind of sickness he has.
She will tell him that they both have AIDS, that she was addicted to heroin.
The only thing that I really worry about is getting real sick, because I've been very, very sick. I've almost died twice.
Maybe it's not a huge problem yet among heterosexuals. Maybe it's not a huge problem yet among children. But, I mean, how big do we want the problem to get before we're going to do anything about it?
What are y'all going to do about AIDS? What are you going to do? Yeah, I'm one of them. I'm one of them.
He is not close to anyone who has AIDS. But he is suing an insurance company he says discriminates against homosexuals because of the AIDS crisis. That indirect association with the disease has been enough to make David Hurlburt a virtual leper.
I'll tell you when I felt alone. Just after I was in the newspaper because of the lawsuit, I went into the washroom at my company and noticed that other people in the washroom had stopped flushing the toilets. I later heard that it was because now several people are afraid that they're going to catch AIDS from me because I flushed the toilets in the washroom. I wanted to cry about it, is what I wanted to do. But now what I do is flush toilets and not think about it.
Like other gay men in San Francisco, Hurlburt discovered that insurance companies have set special standards which can deny coverage to homosexuals, AIDS or not. And AIDS or not, anyone with any connection to the disease can wind up among the new untouchables. People have been fired from their jobs, evicted from their homes, cut off from family and friends. The fear of AIDS breeds discrimination. Janet Bruner was fired when her boss found out she simply had volunteered to help people with AIDS.
Yeah, I've been treated like I had the disease, even though I do not have the disease, even though they could not, no one can get the disease from me because I don't have it.
Happy birthday to you.
Blow out your candle.
Ryan Thomas got AIDS from a blood transfusion just after he was born. He's been fighting the disease ever since. He didn't have to fight the discrimination until this year, when he was old enough to go to kindergarten.
One little boy that has the AIDS virus in his blood, and the whole community, just about, is afraid of him and afraid of the virus.
But they don't have to worry about, getting it from Ryan or from us. You know, unless they have sexual contact with Ryan or direct contact from blood-to-blood contact with Ryan, they don't have to worry about catching it.
Actually, for a few days last month, Ryan did join other students in Atascadero, California, but under the especially careful eyes of school officials.
We're overly cautious, perhaps, but we're cautious on things like every kid have their own pencils, so they wouldn't be sharing and chewing on each other's pencils.
But when another child picked a fight, Ryan bit him and was suspended from school. His parents are suing.
If we can take it straight from the doctor that he has AIDS and still not be afraid of him, they can at least accept it and learn a little bit about it. I mean, I've had one girl come up to me and ask me how I could put Ryan in school knowing that he was going to kill all the kids at the school.
Well, the bottom line is he isn't any other child, and he does have to be treated a little differently.
Those parents who don't want Ryan in school say they need proof positive that AIDS cannot be transmitted by casual contact.
It'd be different if it was something where they were just going to get sick and it was going to run its course, but we're dealing with death here.
There is no 100% guarantee, but there isn't on nothing. The chances of Ryan spreading AIDS in school are over 1,000,000 to 1. The chances of them kids being killed on the way to school are 5,000 to 1, but they still send their kid to school every day.
You know, if we saw the car coming, we'd move our kids. In this instance, we can see it coming, and we just want to be sure with our kids.
Ryan does have some friends, but as long as AIDS remains such a potent source of fear, those associated with it are likely to be shunned more often than they are embraced.
It's not Ryan so much, it's the AIDS, and it's impossible to make people understand and feel comfortable.
This thing hasn't changed my love. I would never stop loving him, no matter what.
Beth Israel Medical Center, New York.
And I don't know about
the woman is speaking to a hospital counselor. Johnny, her son, is about to die of AIDS. Johnny's sister, too, has come for the death watch.
How did you feel about it when you first found out, and how did you cope with it?
I cried till I did not know that so many tears could come from one person. I cried because I don't want to give him up.
To his dying days, Johnny never told his mother about his homosexuality or the AIDS. Taboo topics back home in the hill country of Virginia.
He was my son. And I don't know about other mothers. But I don't see how one could turn one down. I really don't. I've loved him too long.
We spoke to mothers, fathers, and lovers of people with AIDS.
On a December morning in 1983, my daughter called me up and told me about her boyfriend contracting AIDS and that it was a sexually transmitted disease. Nobody knew a cure for it. That struck terror in my heart.
And he said very casually, "Oh, well, there's good news and there's bad news." And I don't remember what the good news was. He goes, "The bad news is that I've got AIDS, but don't worry about it, Mom, I feel great." That was in May. In fact, it was a week before Mother's Day. And he died this past June 30th.
What's the roughest part of it? What's the toughest thing for you?
I guess in a way, it's the helplessness that one feels. Seeing, you know, your offspring ill and being not being in a position to really give any direct aid.
You just kind of wish all the time that it would just go away and you could have your life back.
I think I would be angry at the person who transmitted it to my daughter or my son.
Well, he didn't know. And he was a kind person. He was a loving person. He was a caring person. He wasn't trying to hurt her. And he died a horrendous death.
Do you find yourself thinking, why me, why my son, why did it happen to us?
I did sort of say why Dave, because it seemed that his life was valuable, but then who might have said that his was more valuable than someone else's?
She was talking about my lover, David. I can't imagine anything more difficult than watching the person you love most in the world die. Painfully and slowly and without hope.
Here's an extraordinary circumstance. The two of you are in the same room talking about the same person with great love and affection. I think I've been around enough to know that a lot of people are going to say, this is really unusual. Do you feel it's unusual not to feel any anger, any hostility, any blame going in the direction of your son's friend and lover?
No, of course not. David loved James. Why shouldn't I love him? And if I hadn't loved him for himself, I would certainly for the care that he took of Dave.
How do you answer the question of, well, if I had had a different lifestyle, if he had a different lifestyle, maybe this wouldn't have happened?
This virus has no idea what David's lifestyle was. It has no brain. It's not a moral judgment. It's just a medical aberration, a horrible thing.
Broadcast, the terrible price of AIDS is expressed most tragically in human terms. For society and for the government, the dollar cost of medical care over the next few years could be staggering. Who will pay? Who should pay?
Look at his will. What's going to happen to the will?
3-year-old Alex has AIDS. Insurance pays $15,000 a month in home nursing costs.
His medication, which he takes 3 times a day intravenously, is about $50 an infusion. The nursing is $17 an hour, but that's much better than in the hospital.
Nick's medical bills have run over $235,000. That's covered by insurance, but AIDS has cost him a career he'd worked very hard to build.
I've had colonoscopies. I have had bronchoscopies, which is washing of the lung. I have had, oh my goodness, so many, it's hard to think.
If you designed a disease to do the worst possible damage to a person, you'd come up with AIDS. If you designed a disease to make it as difficult as possible for insurers to deal with, you might come up with something very much like AIDS.
You have 2 lesions.
Major East and West Coast cities that form the AIDS Belt pick up the brunt of payment for the uninsured. But by 1990, the cost will rise dramatically in middle America.
by that year, AIDS is going to be to Minnesota what it is now currently in New York and San Francisco.
With the prospect of the new drug AZT, some doctors are taking extraordinary measures to keep patients alive long enough to get it. When AZT is approved early next year, costs may soar.
I think it's almost certain that AZT is going to increase the cost of caring for patients that actually have AIDS because it will prolong their illness.
Insurance companies say they won't issue new policies if they've determined you're at risk for AIDS. Like many AIDS patients, Alex's insurance runs out this year. Welfare won't pay for nursing care at home, only in a hospital.
To have him hospitalized would cost at least four times as much as what he's being treated with at home.
I never go to the hospital ever again. I'm going to stay home.
Many AIDS patients are too sick to work. Others are fired when employers discover they have AIDS. Some must quit their jobs to be eligible for state or federal health benefits.
They will have to go on to Medicaid to get their hospital bills paid, but they can't go on to Medicaid until they've spent down their assets to a certain amount. So we invite people from the middle class to become a member of the welfare class.
The drop to the welfare class is fast and devastating. Even with insurance, the financial impact hits AIDS patients and their families hardest. This was Doug's family home before it was repossessed by the bank.
My parents have made it very clear to me that even though I've lost their home and their security and their nest egg in life and their retirement home and money, it's no big. They just said, son, you did your best. It was too big of a project, and we love you, and you don't owe us anything.
Paul Castor was fortunate to have VA benefits, but even with good medical coverage, the Castor family's financial system eroded even faster than Paul's immune system.
His family, he's my son, he's my baby. No way in the hell I'm going to take and turn against them like I know a lot of other people have turned against these poor kids, and I think it's a damn shame.
Even being at home, it's too much. It's too much on them. They're not well themselves.
What's the hardest part?
Facing reality. Am I right, Paul?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Scientists fighting the war against this awful disease do have one powerful weapon. They know what causes AIDS, and they know how to prevent it, if only people listen.
It's embarrassing to most people to talk about sex, to say safe sex means you have to use condoms. Well, that's the kind of thing that is going to have to start happening if we're going to stop the spread of AIDS.
That word is getting out in some cities, cities mostly where there's been a lot of AIDS. This is Booker T. Washington Junior High School in Miami.
And I want to ask, how can you prevent from getting AIDS?
Nurses from a local hospital have come to explain the new facts of life to students. Students likely to be experimenting with both sex and drugs. And the nurses pull no punches.
People often say, is there an AIDS vaccine? And we always say, yes, there is. It's called a rubber.
I know you may feel like a jerk buying them or taking them out or putting them on, and you don't think it's romantic.
Sex, Drugs, and AIDS is a new education film aimed at the same audience and just as frank.
I don't want to get pregnant. I don't know what to use because I don't want any diseases either. You know, I just...
What do you use? I use condoms.
Just can't believe it. I don't think anybody uses those anymore.
That's not the
Released
point.
Only this fall, the film has been purchased by organizations in more than a dozen states already. The Army, too, has an AIDS movie, a new kind of training film.
Well, I liked what I saw. And before long, every chick on the street knew me by name.
The acting may be questionable. The message is not.
What can you do to protect yourself? The most obvious, of course, is don't have sex with prostitutes.
Warnings are being pushed now, too, by the Surgeon General in new TV spots and in a highly explicit pamphlet about AIDS. Its main targets, low-income groups at risk because of high rates of drug abuse, and the young.
They are very active sexually. They are having a lot of partners. And when you do take a history, you find out they may have had three or four partners in one weekend.
And they know next to nothing about AIDS.
I now hear you can get it from toilet seats.
Do you ever worry about it?
I just think it's something that's not going to happen to me.
Gee, I don't want to
go around asking about AIDS, you know, people might think I have AIDS or might think that I'm, you know, I'm a homosexual.
It's an unmentionable type of a thing.
Today, mentioning the unmentionable and getting the word out about prevention is the only answer. Just ask those who didn't know.
Please, I beg of you, I do not want anybody to go through what I've gone through, you know.
All people have to become involved with this and to understand this disease. It's the laws of self-preservation.
Which brings us back to the hospital rooms, where the little victories and the inevitable defeats are played out each day. Here's what's happened to some of the people with AIDS we have come to know and respect during this report. Tony was well enough to leave the hospital over the weekend, still toughing it out. Paul learned that he too might go home in a few days, to the winter he so dreads. Johnny remained in an irreversible coma. His mother said her goodbyes and returned to the hill country where he was born. And this man, Bill, who'd been watched over lovingly by his mother, received a final benediction.
He asks for your forgiveness, son. He also asks for a peaceful death, a death which will take him right from here into your arms. And we ask that this might be a beautiful, peaceful time for him until he dies. We also ask for a release of some of the pain that he's going through. And when it's time, we ask that you take him home and that he pray for us from his place with you.
Bill died last Sunday.
Amen.
Considered to be the most serious health problem.